Ever had trouble properly sizing dehumidification equipment? We're going to tackle the basics as well as the one thing everybody gets wrong, and that's coming up next. Greetings and welcome to this week's Primed Insight. Recently we had a customer that was needing to hold the blast on a structure that he was blasting and painting. This is typical when you're doing like large tank projects, as it allows you to completely blast the tank, then clean up once, and then paint out the tank, like the tank floor. What you're trying to control is the atmospheric relative humidity inside the tank. It's RH. This measurement is calculated as a percentage, and in order to hold the blast, you need the RH to be below 50%, and that's where the size of your DH unit matters. In this application, you're trying to protect steel, because it's bare after being blasted. If you turn that air over with DH in that space 2 to 4 times an hour through that dehumidifier, it's going to be fine. In preparation for painting, keeping the relative humidity low enough in that space, provided it's controlled and not open to atmosphere for an extended period of time, this will protect you from flash rusting. Let's put those 2 to 4 air changes per hour into a real life scenario. Assume you have some sort of structure which is 30 feet times 25 feet by 20 feet. To calculate the size dehumidifier required is quite simple. You determine the cubic feet inside the enclosure. This is 30 feet times 25 feet times 20 feet. It comes to 15,000 cubic feet. You multiply that by the air changes required per hour to keep the RH under 50. If the containment is tight, use 2 to 3 air changes. If it's loose, with air leaks, use 4 changes per hour. We can go ahead and multiply that by 4 because we know 4 air changes every hour will be sufficient for this tank. Take 15,000. Multiply by 4 to get 60,000 cubic feet per hour. To get the CFM, cubic feet per minute, which is how the units are rated, we're just going to divide that number by 60, because there's 60 minutes in an hour. So that comes out to 1,000 CFM, and that's it. So a 1,000 CFM dehumidifier would turn the air over in that containment 4 times every hour. Alright, so now 4 times per hour is pretty aggressive for most areas. What you'll find that no matter how big the tank is, it's probably not going to be as many CFM as what you would expect. If the space is very airtight, you may get away with like 2 to 3 air changes every hour. Of course, there are other considerations and limitations that you need to be mindful of. As an example, there are 2 basic types of dehumidifier units. One that uses a desiccant wheel, and the other that uses refrigerant. The desiccant style can be used any time, while the refrigerant style cannot be used below 55 degrees Fahrenheit, which is 13 degrees Celsius. So let's talk about the refrigerant style for a second. Now that's a little bit different when you're using refrigerant-based dehu. It's slightly different in cooling. As mentioned before, it's going to work down to that 55 degrees Fahrenheit 13C. An air conditioner will simply stop removing around that 60 to 65 degrees or 15 to 18 Celsius. So if you're in a really hot environment and it's going to stay hot, you could use an air conditioner to pull that moisture down. Because an air conditioner, if it's sized right, will typically maintain a 45% relative humidity in that given space. We can't cool air without drying it. It's just not possible by nature. Hot air simply holds more water than cold air. So if we take a volume of air and we can make it colder, it physically can't hold the same amount of water. That's the psychometrics. So if you're in a really hot environment, one of those 80, 90 degree days, or 30 degrees Celsius, and it's going to stay that way, it's not going to hurt you to cool it down inside a little bit. If an air conditioner is the closest thing to the project site, just grab an air conditioner. Just make sure your size are right, okay? So you want to use the same formula and do the air changes. Make that calculations. Make sure you've got the 2 to 4 air changes in there. And with that machine, we're not using it for cooling at that point. We're actually using it for drying. It's probably never going to satisfy the internal temperatures for a human, but in practice, you actually need a lot more tonnage to cool the space than you do to dry it. Because drying is going to happen the entire time. So much so, you're going to have water pumping out of that machine non-stop. So you can use air conditioners for drying. However, you want to be careful about the dew point. You can check the dew point on your Defelsco DPMO logger or a hydrometer before you go blasting that tank with cold air. An AC unit is going to put out 50 degrees or 10 degrees Celsius air. So you want to make sure you double check the dew point in that space. If the dew point is 60 degrees or 15C on the steel, and we hit it with a 50 degree, 10 degrees Celsius air, the water in there is going to condense and it's going to make rust. So you want to make sure when you turn that AC on that we're not going to hit the dew point. Of course, with dehumidification, continuous checking of the site environmental conditions is very important, and having the correct tools for the job is a big advantage. A simple hydrometer and some psychometric charts are an easy way to spot check the RH. Of course, a much easier method is to use that Defelsco DPML logger. This can be connected remotely via Bluetooth technology and spot checked on your phone, as well as having the data uploaded to the cloud. A few other things to be considering when you're talking about dehumidification. There are applications where adding dehu at the same time as a dust collector can change the environment. You need to talk to us about these things. You need to make sure that CFM is roughly equal or higher what you're putting into what you're taking out. When adding heat to a space, especially when the temperatures are cold or cool outside, it's critical to bring the temperature up slowly to avoid any condensation on that work surface. You've always got the problem of having static pressure losses in those long duct runs, so you can add inline blowers. That's a fairly common practice. Of course, the best practice is to never pull a return on a tank through an AC unit unless you absolutely have to. So from this insight, you can see these are just high level tips. If you have some specific issues that you're trying to resolve on your job site, or if you have unusual site conditions, feel free to reach out to BlastOne and get some qualified advice. Thanks for watching this week's Prompt Insight. We'll see you next week.